What the heck is delayed sequence intubation?
Here's a small study on DSI published in the Annals of Emergency Medicine in 2014.
Ketamine is used in medical units all over the world for procedural sedation, dislocated shoulders, radiographic studies in children, and much more. Think about DSI as nothing more than procedural sedation with ketamine, where the procedure is oxygenation. I think an example will help, so I'm going to begin this module a little bit differently by sharing a clinical experience I encountered. Dispatch sent my partner and me for an overdose. The patient was a middle-aged female found supine in bed in a poorly lit space with agonal respirations. The patient was well known to law enforcement due to opiate and polysubstance use disorder. Respiratory depression, constricted pupils, drug paraphernalia, alcohol bottles, and other items on the scene confirmed the suspected polysubstance consumption diagnosis. After nasal Narcan, the patient's respiratory effort became rapid, ataxic, and labored, but she remained unconscious. In the ambulance, the patient was markedly agitated. It wasn't easy to keep the leads and the pulse oximeter in place. She was all over the stretcher, smacking the oxygen mask away, yet still, eyes were closed and completely non-responsive, with labored, irregular respirations. One listened to her chest and the diffuse ronchi, and it was clear she aspirated. On a nasal cannula, her saturation reached 86%. Here's the rest of her vital signs. So my partner and I discussed our care plan. The patient had no identifiable anatomical anomalies. We didn't appreciate any difficulty with mask ventilation or laryngoscopy. The barriers to safe MFAM were physiological, as evidenced by her vital signs. Because of a failure of oxygenation and ventilation, a concern over her ability to maintain and protect her airway, coupled with the risk of subsequent aspiration, we chose to secure a definitive airway. This case was our first DSI, and it was beautiful. After administering 1 milligram per kilogram of ketamine and 0.5 milligram per kilogram aliquots, each over 30 to 45 seconds, the patient disassociated. We maintained the high Fowler's position and performed a modified jaw thrust. With the nasal prongs and a tight-fitting non-rebreather, both at 15 liters per minute, the saturation promptly rose to 99%. We administered the remaining 1 milligram per kilogram of ketamine. And while we waited the 3 minutes for nitrogen washout to occur, since it helps to increase the safe apnea time, we called a timeout to review the plan and roles. Then we delivered the paralytic, waited a minute, and secured the airway without breaking a sweat. DSI is one of my favorite algorithms in airway management. I'm not alone in that point of view. At least one pre-hospital agency located in Texas performs DSI on every patient they select to intubate in the field. Their success rate is 100%. No episodes of desaturation, bradycardia, cardiac arrest, or untoward hemodynamics. If there's one thing I've absorbed over the years, it is slow is smooth, and smooth is always faster, and quite frankly, the care is better. DSI makes slow and smooth ever more possible in advanced airway management. Perhaps one of the most extraordinary things about DSI is it restores calm amid the chaos.
It slows down the mayhem so the team can gather their thoughts, assign roles, and avoid missteps. Think about it this way. When a patient is very sick, extremely unhappy, yelling and screaming and trying to escape the ambulance, unwilling to wear an oxygen mask because they're encephalopathic with hypoxemia and hypercarbia, DSI is a brilliant solution. Offering a sedative to allow time for adequate pre-oxygenation slows the whole incident down. The team can develop a shared mental model to plan and prepare, avoiding a precipitous intubation's deadly pitfalls. But wait, why can't we sedate and ventilate the patient with a resuscitation bag? If the saturation is low, it'll improve with mass ventilation. Yeah, that may be true, but remember, the purpose of elective intubation is to avoid mass ventilation episodes because of the inherent risk of poor technique, gastric insufflation, and regurgitation. All of our patients have a full stomach. They haven't fasted for 12 hours like they would before surgery. Bypassing mask ventilation in our predictably unpredictable environment is a good thing whenever we can do it harmlessly. Why is ketamine an excellent drug for delayed sequence intubation? When ketamine is administered slowly, the patient disassociates quickly. They maintain their airway reflexes and they continue to breathe. They will not swat oxygen away, and an air of calm allows an opportunity to fully set up for success. So what should you do specifically after the patient disassociates? Sit the patient up because head of bed elevation reduces atelectatic changes, it improves pulmonary function, and reduces aspiration risk. Utilize a nasal cannula at 15 together with an oxygen mask also at 15. Position the airway and hold a modified jaw thrust. Be amazed at how quickly the cyanosis dissipates and the saturation improves. If the saturation does not improve, it means we need to recruit alveoli. Hypoxia, despite high oxygen concentrations, is evidence of shunt physiology, which requires CPAP at 5 of PEEP to start. Do not hesitate to use CPAP in sedated patients. Although the incidence of emesis after ketamine administration is in the neighborhood of 5 to 15%, it does not occur after induction. Emesis from ketamine transpires during emergence. 5, 10, even 15 of PEEP is not enough to open the esophageal sphincter. Plus, you're right there watching. Think about this. When a patient vomits into a non-rebreather, you remove it. You log roll, you turn the head, and you suction. You can do the same thing with a CPAP mask. Once the saturation has reached the high 90s, wait 3 minutes for the oxygen to wash out the nitrogen in the tracheobronchial tree, thereby increasing your safe apnea time. Administer the rocuronium, wait a minute until spontaneous respiratory effort stops, and intubate with the McGrath. One more note, leave the nasal cannula tightly bonded to the patient's face until tube placement is verified. Then the nasal cannula can be removed.